audience who is going to talk to us about the final scheme to start with. And if not, we press on. So to our speaker, who is Dr. Rupert Marshall, I had a few emails asking me whether this was going to be a talk about birds singing or about the book from Sebastian Fuchs and the film about the First World War. Well, I'm able to put your minds at rest, and it's Dr. Rupert Marshall is the real deal. He is talking about birds because he is a reader of animal behaviour at Aberystwyth University. He's a regular tweeter, of course, with over 300 followers. That's to do with computers. He's a frequent speaker of the Squad in Shrewsbury, the premier science and philosophy group, and he has a passion for taking photographs of Aberystwyth sunsets. Dr. Rupert Marshall, can you welcome him, please?
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. And thank you for that introduction there. I was sitting slightly in trepidation, wondering what was going to be said. Clearly somebody's been looking through my Twitter feed. And how appropriate. I apologise if I sound a little gruff and I'm slightly off-key. I've been suffering with allergy for most of last week, and this is my first day back at work, as it were. So on the bright side, I'm here. At the end of the talk. On the downside, he was here. So we'll see how we go. Now, as was mentioned, I'm based at Aberystwyth University, down on the sunny west coast of Wales, which is, you just can't stop taking sunsets when you live there. Though I have to say, I live in Shrewsbury, and looking out from the from my garden up near the column towards the churches, even yesterday evening, as the sun disappeared behind the apple tree, we get just as good sunsets here. And with climate change and rising sea levels, we may shortly be on the coast too. That's another matter. So today I'm going to be talking to you about birdsong, and the hows and whys of birdsong, so what birds do when they're singing, how they sing, and why they sing. And it is, as was mentioned, the perfect time of year to be talking about this, because all of the birds are out there busy singing at the moment. Now, I used to live out in a little place called Dovey Junction, which is essentially in the middle of nowhere, but surrounded by the warblers in the spring and all the birds. And I used to walk to the station there along an old muddy track, and my colleague used to say, well, that must be marvellous, hearing all those birds in the morning. And I said, no, it just reminds me of all the work I need to do. But of course, it is joyful to a certain way as well. So yes, this is me, and when I'm not here, I'm teaching my delightful students in Aberystwyth the joys of behaviour, from guppies to the Greek financial crisis we did the other day, talking about game theory. Now, I know you cover a wide range of scientific topics in your talks here, so for those of you who don't know, I thought I should start with the basics and explain that this here is a bird. And these birds are known to sing. These are the fairly common birds, the great tit, not to be confused with the great hand holding this great tit. This was just a picture taken by one of my students in the woodlands of the university. Now, great tits have very simple songs, but they have quite bright colouring too. And I'm sure you'd all like to hear what they sound like. Can anybody actually tell me what a great tit song sounds like? Would you like to have a go, sir?
I need a knife, and I need to sharpen it.
Security's here, is it? Yes, or a squeaky bicycle bump is also how it's been that line. Yes, it's a very simple sort of song. I'll show you what they sing, but I want to show you first how we can tell what they sing. Now, you might be sitting there thinking, well, I know what they sing because I can hear them. And yes, you can hear their songs, and it's either lovely or raucous or pretty or not. But how can we actually analyse what they're singing? Well, we could sit there and listen very carefully, and indeed, this is what I try and do occasionally when I have a few moments. Also, we can analyse it visually as well. And what I've got here is a little demonstration of that. Now then, here we have what is called a spectrogram in that top section, all of the yellow section here. Here we go. This is essentially where there are yellow bits, there is noise. And this is time moving from left across to right. So if this was a radar sort of signal, it would be a beep, 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 brrr. Something along those lines, which is a secret signal to the people telling them to get coffee ready. Now that's just whether there is sound or not. At the bottom, so do go away, Not really. We have what's called a sonogram. A sonogram, and a sonogram is a picture of song, and I'm going to very quickly make one for you now. Look at that. Marvellous. And this is a picture, it's actually the same one that's at the bottom, so those of you at the back can see as well. What is this sonogram? What it is, it's a picture of sound. So that at the bottom would be a low note, and at the top would be a high note, and a note which just went along the middle would just be a straight tone. But I'm going to illustrate this by recording a song now. Now, can I ask, is anybody willing to come down here and whistle for me? Lots of people looking at their toes. Well, never fear, Rupert's here. Here we have what's called a real-time spectrograph, and I'm going to try to whistle into this to illustrate what's going on. Now, at the moment, all it's picking up is my voice, and my voice is slightly lower than usual. Now, in terms of, I quite like this watching going along. Now, don't worry, we're not recording what you're saying. Well, we are, but that's another matter. It's fairly low-pitched. And if you watch any of the TV detective dramas, when they get these recordings of people, they'll say, well, have a look, hang on, this is that voice we heard in Sainsbury's last week. I'm sure it's that theft we were after, the burglar. And you can actually put these pictures on top of each other and do a little correlation. You can match them up. They're a bit like an acoustic fingerprint. Now, although you can hopefully understand what I'm saying and hear me loud enough, if you can't, put your hand up. So hopefully, you don't need to look at this to tell what I'm saying. And it'd be virtually impossible to tell what I'm saying from looking at this. Human voices tend not to be toneful. Even if I was to sing, which I'm not, it wouldn't really look very pretty on here. But if I whistle, we have a long flat tone. Now, if that was a whistle going up, and I'm just going to wait for it to get to the next line, so we can compare. Here we go. Go compare. Well, hello. And I'll stop that recording now. But the point is that you can see that we can record and visualize what we are hearing. This is indeed a picture of sound, and it's a time picture of sound as well. Now, my whistles aren't terribly complicated. They're fairly simple, but it gives you the general idea. Clearly, with those bird songs that we looked at just now, they are a little bit more complicated. And I'll play this one and see if you can tell me what it is.
The mute swan.
Thank you very much. Now then, with apologies for those in the front row, once more with feeling. Yes, sir.
It's a wren.
It's a wren. It's a Jenny Wren, indeed. Troglodytes, troglodytes. Troglodytes, troglodytes. Now, that's one of Britain's smallest birds, and yet it can produce one of the loudest sounds going as well. Could you hear that at the back over there?
Yeah.
Good. Lovely. Remarkable sound, that all of that in what was the little less than 6 seconds. Now, if we have a look at a different sort of song here, and I'll go back to here now. Here we have back to our great tit song. It's a fairly simple looking sonogram, and you can look at that now, I hope, and you'll be able to say, well, of course, Rupert, one of those notes is higher than the other, and then it goes up, and then it goes down, and then it goes up. So it should be a sort of a sound. Is it? Yes, indeed it is. And I will just adjust my own, because we're now using my sound, or at least, oh, I know, I've got my own volume control here. Just so I don't blast everybody too much. Or not. Let's see how it goes. So that's a relatively simple sound. Now there are differences to those notes, and we're going to come back towards the end to look at this great tit song again. But it does allow us to look at the song in a simple way. Now, for a great tit, you might think, well, if you want to know how much it's singing, I could just sit here and count the notes, and that would be a useful thing to do. And indeed you can. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I've done it. Aren't I clever? The trouble is, when we get to some birds, they're a little bit more complicated. Now, this is technically known as an LBJ, a little brown job. It's a sedge warbler. And they are migrant birds, and they come in from far and wide. But they have this very complicated song. Now we'll come back to the love lives of these little chaps in a moment. Now they don't look much. They have to sing quite a lot, and they can sing 70 or 80 different notes, whistles, tweets, twiddles. As part of their song repertoire. They're quite accomplished songsters. Now, when I say they're accomplished songsters, if you're a female sedge warbler and about to hear this, you'd be having kittens. As humans, you might not necessarily want it in your garden. It's quite raspy sort of sound. And if you now watch this as we go through, it's actually playing this song. So you should start off by hearing the buzz, buzz, diddly dee. Complicated little bit for a while, and then at the end. So we could have a sing along. Here we are, trying again. You see? So when you get your head around it, it's quite simple. But that was all in about 4 seconds. And there's clearly no way you'd be able to count all of that on your own, sitting in the field with a pencil thinking, you missed one, can you go back? It's quite tricky. And to find out exactly what notes it's singing, it's simply impossible for us as humans to tell, and that's why we use these computers to find out what they're singing. But at the same time, I like to think, they're really quite beautiful, some of these patterns that we get as well. They're almost art-like in their own way. And indeed, Cilla McQueen, who's an artist who looks at the different ways in which that we can interpret musical sounds and acoustics, has ended up by designing, and this is a score, if you like, you know what a treble clef looks like, and the standard stave of music. She designed this type of way of defining music for her a piece called Picnic for Violins, Oboe, and Bass Guitar. And when I look at this, and I think, well, actually, these swoops here are really rather similar to those sonogram images we were looking at earlier. We've got some little trills and runs, we've got some sort of harmonic notes here, longer tonal notes, and some swoops down as well. And I look at that and I think, well, that's rather interesting. So somebody's interpreted song. I don't know, by the way, whether she was inspired by song and sonograms or not. I like to think that she was, though. And it's just really me saying that I think these sounds look rather pretty as well as sounding rather pretty as well. I should perhaps explain that when I started out in life many years ago, I studied psychology for my first degree. And I discovered that animals were far easier to understand than people, and moved into birds, and then happened to be introduced to somebody who'd studied birdsong, and it was looking at these sonograms that really transfixed me. And I was looking at these, and I was looking at dialects at the time, and I just thought, wow, this is just incredible. How do the birds do this so precisely every single time? Because you saw those pictures of my voice. Now, that's not beautiful. But these are very precise and neat, and the birds are able to replicate this again and again and again. To the extent that we can use song, both the simple calls that most birds make, alarm calls, begging calls, contact calls, chip, chip, come over here, that sort of a call, and they're very simple ones, and then these complicated songs, and we can use these as an acoustic fingerprint to identify individuals. And it's the same way that, for example, penguins are able to identify their young when they come back from months at sea trying to fish for their offspring. Or indeed here in Shrewsbury, come April, May time, and the swallows come back, and they'll all go and find their little places, perhaps up in the eaves of your houses or on the buildings in town. When the parents come back, if there's a lot of those swallow houses or swallow nests around, they can, particularly when you get large cliffs of cliff swallows, they are able to identify their offspring by their calls. So they are acoustic fingerprints as well. Now, when I go out into the field doing this, and colleagues as well, we have, what this is here is a picture of my laptop, essentially showing the same image as you saw when I was singing. So we get these bird songs racing across the page all the time, and we can see exactly what's going on. Now, of course, sometimes the birds don't sing. And I'm just showing you this to admit that we're all human, and frankly, a little bit crazy. No, not the picture of me at the top. What we've got there is a whole lot of strange-looking sounds going across that screen. This was because I was gazing out the window, wondering when this wretched bird was ever going to sing again. And other things came to my mind, and I started whistling. And then I looked at the screen and regarded, I realised I was recording myself whistling, and that made me laugh, so that's my laugh as well. And then I took a picture because I had nothing better to do with myself. There we go, moving swiftly on. So why do birds sing? Why is it that the birds make such a fuss and to-do about it? Well, generally speaking, it's only male birds that sing. Females tend not to sing at all, but there's a few species where they do, but the general rule is that they don't. And when they do sing, they tend to sing in concert with the males, and they'll do duetting. And we'll come to a little bit of examples of duetting right at the end. Now, here we've just got a stylized version of a peacock, if you like, and a female looking on bemusedly, thinking, what on earth? And then the male, of course, is thinking, well, hello, look at this. Surely. And generally speaking, the female would be impressed. Now, interestingly, with peacocks, of course, and I know we're getting slightly off song, but bear with me. They have all those pretty eyes on their tails, and we know that generally speaking the females prefer the male with the most eyes on his tail. And in fact most of the females will agree. And when all the males are marching around in what's called a lek, essentially strutting their stuff saying, look at me, look at me, look at me. And the females will all decide on who the best chap is, and they'll all go and shake hands with him. You know what I mean? And if you're not the top one or two people, then essentially you're not going to be getting any hands shaken that day. In fact, you're barely worth getting up in the morning. It is important to sing as well as you can and to be the best male you can be. Now, I threw that in because that rather brings us nicely to these people here. Now, there was a story in the newspapers last year about how modern fashions have led to the fact that we're now at peak beard. Well, I beg to differ, and I suggested, in fact, in Victorian times, that was perhaps the era of peak beard. I don't have one, obviously. Now, on the left we have Darwin, on the right we have Wallace. They were both around at the same sort of time, and I'm sure you're aware that Charlie Darwin, of course, not far from round here, and in fact I was brought up in Bromley in Kent, which is just down the road from Down, where he spent most of his life. I got into trouble when I went there as a Boy Scout. It's like I was so interested in all the exhibits, I kept going, ooh, look at this, and then kick the table. And that set off the alarms in the studio. An early interest in natural history. Now, what he was interested in was saying, well, why do birds sing? Well, they're doing, yes, they might be doing it as an alarm to alert for predators, this sort of thing. And in terms of the bird's song, these elaborate songs, which just the songbirds sing, well, they're doing that because it's attractive. It'll help the male find a mate, and we'll call this sexual selection. The male's trying to find a mate. Excuse me. Now, Wallace, a little bit more prudish, perhaps wasn't so keen on this, and he wasn't really in for any of this sexual selection business. He said, no, it's all natural selection. That's the only way forward. So, and he wrote a whole book called Darwinism, when he spent that book having a go against Darwin, essentially, and saying, well, this sexual selection business is all wrong. So why do the birds sing? Well, says Wallace, and I quote, it's due to superabundant nervous energy in the male birds. They sing for the same reason that we humans engage in dancing, shooting, and field sports. Now, times move on, but nonetheless, and the point is that he was perhaps a little off track from what we might now think of as modern evolutionary biology. But this is honestly what he thought, and he didn't think it had anything to do. He thought that the song was merely a way of the male introducing himself to the lady bird. So, good evening. Good evening. Well, apparently not. So there we go. Singing in the brain, singing in the rain, Gene Kelly, etc. I thought I'd throw that picture in. But essentially, as I say, Wallace just thought it was for the superabundant nervous energy. So back to our friend the scent warbler. Now, they don't look terribly attractive here to us, perhaps. They're not as colourful as the parrots or some of our other species, even robins, blue tits, grey tits. But they do have these amazing songs. Now, the thing is that these birds live down in Africa, down in sub-Saharan Africa for much of their lives, and they'll come back up to us in the summertime to breed. So they've just flown thousands of miles. When you have one of these chaps in your hand, and they weigh maybe at most 20 grams, some of the smaller birds maybe 10 grams, that's like a couple of paper clips. They're really little balls of fluff. And they arrive back and they'll start singing. And they'll start singing and they'll carry on singing until they find a mate. Some of them find a mate very quickly, within a couple of days. That means that some of these birds only sing for 2 or 3 days a year on the breeding ground. Now, as a scientist, I find that very annoying, because I don't have long to go and record them. For the females, it means that when they come, they can only ever choose from amongst those who are currently singing. And those with the largest repertoires, the one with more of these twiddly bits, will pair first. But of course, in some ways, they are picking, well, I suppose the males as a whole are rather like bad boyfriends. You know, they buy the chocolates and buy the flowers, and then as soon as you say yes, they just sit down and press the floor. But they certainly don't sing anymore. Now, in terms of the sedge warbler, it's very much a case of quantity of what they sing, and how much they sing is really important. That's not all the case, not always the case for all birds. And what we find in canaries, and this is a small picture there of a domestic canary. If anybody has seen wild canaries, you'll know they're a murky green colour, far less likely to be picked off by predators. Domestic ones, though, have been bred for years in captivity to give happiness to people in their homes. Does anybody here keep canaries as a matter of interest? Before I make any derogatory remarks. Good. No. Well, they're lovely, obviously. But they have a range of different notes which they sing, and we've really got a good handle on what they sing, and I'm using this as an example of birds which, where quality is as important as quantity, if not more important. Here we have a canary, and these are the normal syllables, and I'll play you them now. They're very boring. You can imagine it's just going to be a... Will it? I was in F major, that was C minor. You get the point, it's a very simple song. Now, if they want to attract the females, they need to sing something a little bit more attractive, the scientifically termed sexy syllable. Now, these are a little bit more complicated, and the point is they're made up of lots of little notes thrown together. You know, look at how they do this in a minute. By doing this, it sounds more like a mobile phone. Quite sudden, precise, bullet-like almost. Once more with feeling. And that's those two sections of notes over there. Now those will essentially encourage the female to engage with friendly activities with the male. And we can actually manipulate whether or not these attractive syllables do or not by deleting or adding in silences between the little notes. Now, these are clearly just simple notes. Here we've got a higher note, a middle note, and a lower note, and this is made of about two notes as well. And if we were to put a little silence in between some of these notes, or widen that silence, the key value, by the way, is 0.17 millisecond. If it's shorter than that, the female, to all intents and purposes, think, well, hello. But if it's longer than that, then they'll just carry on boozling around, doing some shopping. So the males have to sing these high quality songs in order to get the males, the females, to respond. How do they respond? And this is an important thing. As scientists, when we're investigating birds, we can then have all sorts of hypotheses, come up with all sorts of ideas. We need to test them and see what's going on. Here we have a short section of video of a canary in a cage. Now it's in an acoustically soundproof cage, and so there might be a bit of sound or noise in the background. Ignore it, and trust me, I'm a doctor, but when I say that that song is an attractive song that we're playing to the female. Now, I apologise, it's slightly out of focus, but that's because of the autofocus on the camera I was using. And of course, it then ends up focusing on the cage itself, but if I open the cage door, then the bird flies out and you don't see anything. So it's a trade-off, you're not going to make the bird here at all. Now, what we have there is the female bird. She's sitting there, just looking out at you, thinking, who are all these people? And she does have all the food, water, and nesting material that she wants. She hasn't heard another bird for a while. We're going to play her some sexy songs. Look at what she does. She puts her tail in the air, she flutters her wings, she puts her head right back. Quite a remarkable display. And then after a while, the male stops singing and the effect wears off. This is a really dramatic display here, and I'll just put it back to the beginning. Now that, it does not look like a natural sort of behaviour. If you have canaries, or if you are devious and you go to a pet shop which sells female canaries in season, and you play them with some of these attractive syllables, do this, it's quite remarkable. I have to say that one of the few things my students remember was the day that the video didn't work and I had to imitate. Now, this is quite a dramatic effect, and what do you think about it? about it. This is just a behavioural response to song. So all the male is doing is singing its song. If we play to the unattractive, the regular syllables, which are more used for communication with other males, she wouldn't have responded like this. Now, if she doesn't respond like this, the male is unable to hop on top, fertilise the eggs, and thus there won't be any offspring. So there's a really strong natural selective force for him to be able to do this. It will all become an evolutionary dead end. But we do see this. Now, you do see this in wild birds as well, and the best ones to look out for it are dunnocks. We'll come to dunnocks again later. Now, dunnocks are quite promiscuous, as it happens, but you will see them going hopping around, and the males will go up to the females with a variety of things, which is a whole other lecture on that. But the female has to raise her tail feathers like that. There's what's called the cloacal kiss. There's no intermittent organ for most birds, and then it will carry on. Now, if they aren't able to do that because the female hasn't raised her tail, there will be no chicks. Sorry, is that me? Right, now, and this is just to illustrate, here we have some little chicks filmed inside an nest box with a blue tit there. So this is what happens when the male gets it right, he sings his song, and the female mates with him, and the chicks hatch. As a matter of interest, and there we've got our little blue tits there, they're all probably starting to nest in your gardens at the moment. It's quite remarkable, I think, that in a matter of about 10 days or two weeks from the time the female starts to incubate them, those eggs are able to hatch. They've gone from a twinkle in the father's eye to little hatched chicks. And 2 weeks later, they're able to leave the nest. Remarkable speed of development when you think of how long it takes most children to leave the house. So there we are. And we'll move on. Now, I mentioned those dunnocks because, of course, whilst they use their song to find a mate, they're not always faithful to that mate. This is from back in the early days of DNA fingerprinting, 1997, when the Daily Mail, who else, came up with the bird table of shame in terms of what the birds were actually getting up to. And what those numbers are is the proportion of chicks in any nest which are illegitimate, i.e. not fathered by the male at that nest. Now, reed buntings are pretty high there at 55%. Dunnocks are close second at 36%. And the whole host of other birds for which now this is known. The mute swan was mentioned earlier when my machine didn't work. I've learned how honest and genuine that mute swan is. They only 0%, i.e. so virtually none of their offspring, scientifically speaking, are illegitimate. So some birds are faithful and others are not, and there's a whole story behind that, but they've got to find the mate in the first place. Is it a plan B they go for if they find the most illustrious singer going is not able to be their partner? It may well be, and there's evidence to suggest that they'll go with the best male available, but they know that the top guy mated a fortnight earlier, and they might pop round behind the bushes, quite literally, in order to obtain the genes for their own offspring, and this we know to be the case. So song is important because it does allow the perpetuation of each individual's genes, and passing it on to the next generation. It's not just used for sexual attraction, though. It's also used for communication between individuals as well. And here we've got a slide one of my PhD students put together a while ago, Emily Montford. Now, this is a picture of a typical English woodland here. Doesn't it look lovely? The bluebells out in May. Here we have our residential great tit up at the top there. And what we then have is the intruder male coming in. Now, this is going on all the time, and if you're walking around the woodlands, you might hear the birds singing and think, isn't it lovely? If you listen carefully, you'll be able to hear some of their interactions. And by interactions, I mean the fact that they might actually occasionally try to take over a little bit of their territory and move snugly over until the other one comes rushing in and says, no, no, you don't, that's mine. And the other one says, oh, yes, I will. But that's not finished, so we'll stop there. The point is, we do get these territorial interactions happening, and the birds use song as a way of avoiding any physical violence. So initially, what will happen is that the male will come along, and he'll be singing away in his territory, and he'll hear another bird singing somewhere where they shouldn't be. Now, they're quite used to all the other birds in their territories around them. It's called the deer-enemy effect. I don't mind you being there as long as you don't move very far. A bit like having the French on the other side of the channel. It's fine until they come this side. And that's the essential the aspect of it, though. What they'll start off doing, if they think something's out of place, is to start to sing at them. And they'll say, tweet, 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 this is me, I'm just reminding you, this is my territory. and the other bird will sing back. If that doesn't have an effect, then they'll start to use the song most similar to the song the other bird is singing. It's a way of saying, yeah, I'm singing at you. I'm singing what you're singing. I'm imitating what you're singing. And this is meant to be a signal, or is interpreted by the other bird as a signal to say, I've been spotted. I need to be very sure of myself before I go forward. If that doesn't work, then they'll start doing something which is very un-English. They'll start interrupting each other. Rather than waiting for the other bird to stop singing, they'll be tweet, 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 tweet. They're not hanging on. What is this? And that's the final stage of song interactions we get between males. After that, we'll end up with some kind of physical interaction or fight. The point is they can avoid any physical costs to this by weighing up each other's ability through song at an early stage. So it sounds beautiful to us, and it might sound beautiful to the female, and grated song is used both for male defending against males and for attracting females, but it also avoids the high cost of physical fighting as well. And to illustrate how we know this, I apologise, it's a bit dark actually, but for the zoologists amongst you, this here is a tree, and beneath it we have my tape recorder, and here we have a grating that's coming in to hear at what's coming out of that tape recorder, and what's coming out of it is of course song, because I'm playing it to see how it will react. There's our grating. Here's another similar shot. Here's one of my other loudspeakers I regularly use in the field here. And here we have a grated coming down, almost sitting on top of it. And in fact, they will come down and sit on top of these speakers. And you imagine in the world of birds, they've never seen a loudspeaker before. They don't have iPods or iPads or anything like that. And they think there's a bird inside, which is why we have to use fairly robust speakers, because they'll come down and they'll start attacking it at times as well, which is worrying for me because I can't afford to buy a new one. So this is how we see what's going on. I have to say, I did a recording once for BBC Springwatch a few years ago, and we did this, and we put out the speaker, and they were filming it, and it was coming down, and it got within about 2 feet of it, and then a helicopter landed in the next room. You can't predict these things, but there we are. Now, sometimes we get slightly unusual responses to these bird songs. Now, over in the field here, we have a loudspeaker on a tripod. This is some work I was doing out in the Outer Hebrides, of which more anon. This is my car window in which I was hiding from the weather and everything else. And I couldn't understand why, looking at my computer screen, the bird had stopped reacting. I was thinking, but it was singing just now. Then I looked out and realised it had gone. Why had it gone? Because... also unintended consequences. I had to drive miles before I got rid of this hound. Now then, a chance to engage your brains. I have a quiz for you. Oh my lord, a quiz. Yes. What I want you to do is to imagine that you are a territorial male. You have your territory. You are defending it against an intruder. And what I've got is a few graphs. Graphs, good lord, real science at last. Now, what we've got here is signal intensity on the x-axis, so the bottom bit going along here. And we've got the response strength up here. So the signal intensity is how strong the intruding male is singing. Is he singing lots? Is he, in which case it's over here? Is he singing not very much, in which case it'll be over here? What is your response strength? Is it, as in this graph here, as the intruder gets stronger, do you get stronger to counter him? Or is it this sort of picture here, where it goes up and then it comes down again? Or is it this? As the intruder's song gets louder, your response gets less and less and less. You've got three opportunities there. Now, just have a few moments to think about that, and I'll take a show of hands whether you think the correct answer is A, B, or C. You're the territorial male. Your response is the shape of this line. Does it go up as the intruder male song increases? Does it go up and then down, or does it just go down? Have a think, and I'll let you have a think for a little bit of musical accompaniment. Feel free to talk. Thank you. or a vowel. Who thinks that it might be A? Give me another. And who thinks it might be B? Right, almost equal number. And C? Just a few. Okay, very good. And did you tend to agree with the person sitting next to you during the speech? Not necessarily. Okay. Well, of course, a good scientist could probably make an argument for all of these. but generally speaking, we might think that this would be the response by a female, so the stronger the response of that intruding male, then the stronger her response too, thinking, good heavens, she's so much better than my male. So we might expect to feel, if I see that response, but that's more likely to be the response by a female if she is on her own. If the other male, if her partner is around, she might not respond like this because she doesn't want to be seen to be having it away with the guy from next door. And this is an important point. We do get what's technically called divorce in birds when the male or the female will leave the other one. And this can be disastrous because it usually means all the chicks will die. So females have to be very careful about this. If they do respond, by the way, now here's a thought. If you're thinking about how do females respond to song, if they're looking for a mate, they're probably going to go for the most attractive, the most loud, the loudest, the biggest thing, whatever it is. If they're already partnered and another one comes in, aren't they responding to it because they like the male and they quite like to have a little bit of how's your father? Are they responding it alternatively because they see it as a threat and they're going to fight it off because they're going to be on the territory? Or do they have a fairly weak response, apparently, because they're running away from it, because they don't want to be seen near it by their partner? Because it's a very attractive male, and if they're caught near it, it's trouble. Or do they run away from it because it's a very attractive, very boisterous, bold male, and it can quite easily kick them out, so she wants to hide. It's very difficult to tell what a female is thinking. That's a lesson in life. The correct answer, generally speaking, would be this one, this middle one. So, by a territorial male to an intruder song, we might expect to see this. In other words, he will start off by increasing his level of response, but after a while, if the intruder male keeps getting stronger, he'll overcome the maximum limit of our poor, helpless householder there, and he'll eventually give up and might or go either go away or hope that the other person goes away. So that is probably the best answer for this particular question. The third one is likely to be by an intruder male. So this is the intruder who starts singing, but the more that he sings, the more that the territory owner is actually singing, and thus he realises he's not up for the job, and he quickly turns around and goes away again. So there are different ways we can think about how animals are responding to these. Now there we go, you can rest your brains now, because we're going to think about how they sing, and how they go about them mechanically, and perhaps you shouldn't rest your brains, because we're going to talk about the brain itself. Here I have two brains. Now, one of them has some little arrows on them. Both of them illustrate the same thing. This lighter area here is the higher vocal center, or HVC, for birds. Which of those is the males, and which of those is the females? Who thinks that the male is the one on the right? Anyone think it might be the one on the left? Yes, absolutely. Good. Notice none of the men said it would be this straight away, just in case they didn't get it. This is indeed the male brain, the one on the right here. Males do the singing. They need that larger brain to process all of those songs. And it's generally thought there's, roughly speaking, one neuron per note that they sing. Females don't sing. They've got a few contact calls and they'll give an alarm call. So why do they have a relatively large HVC? Why do females need that bit of brain? Well, the answer is they need to be able to tell how good the males are. Do they walk into the woods and think, well, it all sounds the same to me? Or do they walk into the woods and say, well, actually, I think this chap here is slightly better than this one over here? Because if they're able to do that, they're likely to be onto a good thing. They'll be gaining benefits in some way, not only mating a good singer, but for some species that means getting a male who will be helping to feed the chicks more than will a low singing male. It might indicate his health. We know in some species the amount they can sing or the quality of their song is an indicator of their health. So yes, here we have the males with the larger song brain, the females with the smaller song brain. We see variations between species and within individuals as well. And as an example of this here, just a few more sonograms. Here we have a reed warbler at the top, a marsh warbler, and the sedge warbler. It doesn't look very complicated in this example. You've already heard a sedge warbler. Now, they're all fairly complex ones, and they all have fairly large brains. Compare that with the grasshopper warblers. And we've got a few examples of those here. Very, very simple. This one in the middle goes on and on and on like this all day. It's just one note. How do they do that? When do they breathe? That's another case. But you might like it. That's enough, please. Good Lord. Yes. It's a very, very simple song. It requires a tiny amount of brain to do, and they have much smaller brains, the birds who sing these simpler songs. Great hits. Another one, only a couple of notes. They've got a repertoire of a few different songs, as it happens. It's a different sort of system. But again, they'll have the smaller brains, we think, than we find in species who can sing more. So brains are important for singing. If somebody tells you your bird brain, this is a compliment. They've got quite large brains. Imagine yourself as a nightingale or something. Say, well, thank you very much. Now, this is a tricky graph. I don't normally go for tricky things or text even, but this is just to illustrate how important the brain size is. What we've got along the bars, you'll see that this bar is shorter than this one. If you can't see that, there may be issues. And indeed, it gradually gets taller as we go along over there. What that is the proportion of song syllables, if you like, or notes, that two neighbouring males sing. So when male A, the sedge warbler, came back from South Africa and started singing, and was sitting next to, in the field, male B, they didn't share very much. But over the next 5 days, they hugely increased the amount of similar notes which they sung. It's like keeping up with the Joneses, really. That was like, I was thinking that. And the other one thought the same. And here, well, that's all, you know, very nice and all the rest of it. So what's this line along here? That line along there is their total repertoire size, how much they sung at all on any one day. What that tells us is that even if they're picking up songs from their neighbours, so they've got more in common, as they do that, they're dropping some of the less popular numbers. It's like a jukebox, and you want to put a new record in it, you've got to take an old record out. Your jukebox can only play 50 songs. If you've got an iPod, it's the same thing. You've got to delete a few tracks before you can put some new tracks in there. Their brain is a fixed size. It can only sing so many songs. So in order to keep up with the Joneses, they've got to go throw away some of the old Smith songs. So there we go. So the brain is a fixed size. They can only sing a certain amount. How do they do it? Here's a little video of a brown-headed cowbird. And that is a cowbird song. And I'm going to just pause this here so I can explain what's going on here. What we have is, this is the trachea, or the throat, of the brown-headed cowbird, and it's going down into their two lungs, because we've all got two lungs. Now, unlike in, let's see if I can get that back to the beginning. You have it beginning? Oh, thank you. There we go. In humans, and most mammals, the voice box is fairly high up, and I can make the sound that I'm making now. Good evening, and welcome. And you can make all the similar ones. The birds have it rather different, much, much lower down. They have a voice box at the top of each, a tube going to each lung. So they can actually make different sounds from each side. Very clever. And this is what this little video is going to illustrate for you by some clever work, recording what's coming out of each track by some people in America. This is the air coming in, the air going out, a big lungful of airs, and then note what happens. It's actually going to sing this up here. Just on the left. The low notes on the left, the high on the right. And then finally, you might not even hear that. Very, very high notes at the top there. It's almost just distorting my speaker because it's such a high note. So really quite remarkable what's going on there. I'll just play it again. At full speed, it's there we go, there it is. And as I say, most birds will sing the lower notes on the left-hand side, the higher notes on the right-hand side, and we do get this alternation. So sometimes, here we go, right side not used, alternating which side is being used. Just a few very high notes just from the right-hand side there. quite remarkable behaviour and physiology of the birds which allows them to do this, but clearly we've got that going back to Darwin, it's sexual selection which has selected them to be able to do this, because if they don't do it, they're not going to be getting very far at all. Now, just to illustrate, I'm hoping this is going to work, I'm going to illustrate now a real bird singing. This is a bird that I recorded a few years ago, as you can see, up on North Uist. It's a very short clip, and I'm showing you this, because I want you to have a look at what the bird's doing and how it's moving around. There he is, just singing on his little post there, and his sort of body shook a little bit as he sung like that, and it's a bit of a windy day. It's actually a very sunny day, which is unusual. Now I'm going to show you something else. This is from a piece of art that was done by Marcus Coates a few years ago. What he did was to get amateur singers to come and to sing the songs of birds. But what he did, because as we've seen, those birds sing really high and really fast, so he slurred them down so that they could hear what the birds were singing. He played that to them over a little earphone and then got them to mimic what they were hearing. And once he'd done that, he then sped up the film and played it back at the original speed that he'd recorded the birds at, and used this as an installation of artwork. Now, he was interested in how birds sing together in the dawn chorus, so he actually went out and recorded the birds in the middle of a field and used those same recordings. And when he put these videos up, he put them in an art gallery and hung them around as video installations, so you could walk around, and it honestly sounds as if you're in the middle of a woodland. Now, here I've queued up, I hope. Here is a part of that video. And see what you think of this. Quite remarkable how fast her chest is moving there. Now, birds have a much higher metabolic rate. And of course, the song mimics that to a certain extent as well. So we're actually, through an artist, as a biologist, we're learning aspects of physiology and how the birds work just by comparative work. Now, other aspects, of course, are also set up, like the way he twitches his foot there or does little things like that. Now, how many times have you seen a bird just do that with a little twitch of its wing? And so it goes on. But this is just to illustrate that these, when you see a bird singing, partly it is doing that because, or the way that it sings is linked to its physiology and to its metabolic rate. Yeah, thanks very much. I think that's about all. Lovely lady in the bath there. And there we go. Target moment, always finished. There we go. So you can go and watch all of those if you want to on that web link. But the point is, as I say, it's a very neat way to understand what's going on, is to take yourself out of that situation and then look at those songs and signals from a different point of view. Here are those corn buntings again. And here we are in Shrewsbury. And there are different dialects and ways of speaking, and we're all aware of that. And I sort of teach in a maybe sort of BBC style English, I suppose, or received pronunciation, as it's sometimes called. But we all know we have dialects around the world and around the UK, and even in fairly localised areas as well. Birds do the same, and birds have dialects, not only in between, say, big towns or big geographical distances, just because they don't hear each other, but sometimes they're learned, and we get a patchwork quilt of these dialects, to the extent that all the animals in one field will sing one song, and just across the hedge, you have 20 other birds singing a completely different song. That's what we get in these birds, the corn buntings, now tragically disappearing fast, and the RSPB is doing some amazing work to work out why, and sadly not getting there but at the moment. They've got these very tight sonograms. These both look different, I'm sure, I hope you'll agree, but there's some similarities to them. You've got some introductory chippy notes, some complicated stuff in the middle, and then there's a sort of a trilly thing at the end. Let's hear what they look like, sound like. Now, that always makes me smile. It's the first species I ever studied, the corn bunting, so I'm going to play it again because I can. That's the second one, sorry. So, first one again. Second one. There are subtle differences to it. It's actually much easier to see the differences than it is to hear. Now, when you spend several weeks in the field, you get an ear for this. These birds are doing this all the time, and I do this visually. But the point is, we can then work out that these birds are singing in dialects, and that's important because we can tell where these birds have come from when they move around islands or move around the countryside. It also, as it turns out, is important for the females because they can then, they will choose their males appropriately. Now, the dialects have two different songs usually, they have two different beginning bits. And I've illustrated this here by putting them on top of each other. Now, if you look at the right-hand side here, it's identical, but the left-hand side is very different. I've enlarged it slightly to show that. That is because if I was to talk to you like this all the time, you'd very easily get bored and stop listening to me, so every now and again I need to change the pitch of my song, and then we'd suddenly wake up again when I change it. That's why birds change their song. It's why the great tip might have a teacher, teacher, and then a different song. They'll change this to dishabituate the listeners, and this is why they have them even in dialects as well. Now, just to illustrate how you do this complicated field recording, the bird in that video you just saw is on this post over here. Here's my car. Note the high-tech McVitie's fruit biscuit, which is popping the camera up. It's David Attenborough all the way, it really is. Of course, it's hard work doing this field work up on the Outer Hebrides, it really is. We have to relax now and again. If you haven't been there, I do recommend going there. You actually land on the beach if you go to Barrow. They come in and fly. It's just a beautiful place to go. Although I have to say, I took that picture in Glasgow Airport, because they've got a giant poster on the wall. Here's my picture on a slightly rainier day. Maybe the security fence to keep the sheep off the low tide. But it is worth going. And it's a slightly strange world up there, because you don't know whether to go to Castle Bay to the left or to the right. But if either way you go, you'll come across these different dialects of birds on the one side of the island and the other side of the island. And I'll be honest, it took us 5 minutes to work out which way we should go that day. So there we go. Now, this is not the island of Barrow, this is Asia, and this here in the middle is the Himalayan plateau. And this is to illustrate how birds learn what they sing and how that can have important long-term consequences, because each bird will learn its song. There are various ways they do that. But what happened here was that the birds started singing down at the bottom here, and then over evolutionary time they spread out. Now the Himalayas, if you don't know, are fairly high and inhospitable, and the birds can't live there, so they spread around the Himalayan plateau. And as their populations expanded, they went round and round until they met at the top, and some of them went over here. Now what happened there? Well, the birds could all sing and they could all understand their neighbour, and they all spread out and they moved around and round and around until they got up to the top. When they got to the top, in this hatched area here, they met each other and knew each other not. This happened over evolutionary time, and they ended up having overlapping territories. They ignored each other's song, they don't mate with each other. All the way round, it's one species all the way round, with certain subspecies, but essentially it's the same one. They can all respond, each neighbour responds to each other, but where they come together at the top, they don't. It's what's called a ring species. This is sort of becomes a behavioural barrier to breeding. There's nothing physiologically to stop these birds from breeding, except for the behaviour, except for their song. They're not singing the right song. Very important. And you can see that here. This is the maximum frequency, a very high song, here, which is sung by the bluebirds, and then the redbirds are singing a much lower song over here. And now all the way along, there's not that much difference, but between these two, there's a huge amount of difference, and that's what stops them essentially from understanding each other. So that's a big difference that we can get from learning. I just threw that in for fun. That's the brain of a bird. It's complicated. Let's move on. Now, that was a big around the Himalayas. We also find differences even in major metropoli, like, for example, Shrewsbury. Now, here's Shrewsbury this morning, going up wild hop. Possibly. And here's where I live out in the countryside, a little bit quieter. Now, what we know is in a range of species now, the birds are adapting their songs because of what we're doing to the environment. And here we actually have, just to show you, two great tips. This is work that was done in Sweden where I used to work by some colleagues. Now you'll notice, hopefully, that the bird on the right is much yellower than one on the left. And that's because the caterpillars in the city don't have all the carotenoids in them. Carotenoids, carrots, they're orange, they give them food colourings, all that sort of thing. And they're much paler as a result than our country birds. So we see these colourful differences between cities and rural areas. we also see differences in what they sing. And on the left, we've got a recording in the woodland. There's a little bit of distortion in the background because we've got leaves on the trees. And then you've got here all the traffic and that number 23 bus, which never seems to turn up because it's stuck in traffic over there. Notice also, here we've got the notes going from low to high, from low to high, and here it's all high. They've moved their notes up. They don't sing those low notes anymore in the noisy urban areas. Now I've tidied this up. And there it was. My apologies for being so sudden, the rural somewhere. And I put this red line in so you can see what a constant frequency is and how these urban birds have moved up. Is that low song again? And then the higher urban song. You can hear that difference, yeah? Now, we know that when we play these songs back, we play the city birds to the country birds, they don't respond as strongly. They do respond a bit, but it's as if they're taking a moment to think, okay, I'll move. Now, the same when you play the songs to the country birds, to the city birds. Now, does that mean, over time, we're going to have different species evolving? This is speculation, I have to emphasise. But in theory, this sort of thing could happen, and we could get this sort of behavioural barrier to breeding. We also get lots of echoing effects in cities as well. And just to illustrate that, this is a song which has been recorded up close and personal within a few metres of the bird, and then recorded about 12 metres, 12 yards away, and then about 50 yards away. Well, it would have been. And I'm sorry it's not, but what we have here are very clear notes, some distorted notes, and some very distorted notes. Because you think in cities, we've got all those flat-sided buildings, we've got the nice tarmacadam with a few potholes in it. All of that helps the songs to echo, and that causes problems for the birds to actually interpret what is being sung. Does that mean perhaps that in urban areas we're going to find that birds are less reliant on acoustic signals than they are on visual signals? This is something else that's being investigated by people at the moment. Essentially, though, song tends to get handed on. It might be handed on genetically, it might be handed on because the offspring learn it from their parents. And this is just a little schematic to show you what they sing. At the top here, we have a tutor song sung by a zebrafinch. Now, if you've heard a zebrafinch sing, and you're me, you'll think, well, frankly, that's not song. But people call it song, so we'll call it song. 40 days into subsong, and the little birds, whoops, are learning their first sound, and it looks a bit rough and ready. But after 60 days, they're getting a little bit closer to what a tutor is singing. 80 days, it's really getting very similar. And after 100 days, it's almost identical with a few little personal tweaks thrown in. They're able now to sing identically what's being played at them. Now, the important thing, of course, is what to sing, and you don't want to sing the wrong bird's song. That will lead to all sorts of trouble. And generally, birds don't. They've got a template. Starlings are always regarded as a good mimic, but they still sound like a starling, even when they're mimicking something else. And that goes for most mimics, except perhaps for the lyre birds and that sort of thing. This isn't a lyre bird, this is a red-winged blackbird, and it's an illustration of what can go wrong if they record the wrong thing. Here we've got their song. Note this high-frequency bit up here. If you delete that from a recording and only play the low-frequency songs, they'll still respond, because high-frequency ones disappear very quickly in the environment. But if you play only the high-frequency ones, they don't respond at all, because they never normally hear that. So they're not programmed to do that. The important thing is this whistle down here. Now, many of you know that travel by train, and you hear that rather annoying ding, ding, ding. This train has been cancelled, or whatever it happens to be. The point is that ding, ding, ding alerts you that something important is following you, and you know what to expect after that. With birds, they do the same. And with the red-winged blackbirds, North American species, they have this little whistle at the start, just to say, pay attention, boys, here I come. And they'll start singing. And if you play that, they will learn whatever follows it. And they will even learn the sound of a squirrel alarm call. Somebody's done the test, and the little birds started learning and responding to squirrel alarm calls, even though they shouldn't have done, because they're blackbirds, they're not squirrels. There we go. So, there's Americans for you. What we do find is the cues that the birds need to follow are important to consider. They don't just learn whatever you play them, they learn what they expect to hear, and they listen out for particular cues, so they know what to learn. And there's a lot to fit into a short lifetime for a bird, so it's not just a case of listening carefully, they'll actually learn while or practice while they're sleeping. Now, And this has been shown in zebra finches, that you can see the same wave patterns in their brain that you see when they're awake and when they're singing as when they're asleep. And I like to think that this is when I was learning an instrument when I was small. And I didn't always, I was a busy boy. I had to be running around doing all sorts of exciting things. I didn't always have time to go and practice. And yet, miraculously, by my next lesson, I'd have improved slightly. Not a lot, but a little. Now, this is what we think is going on with the birds here. They're using their unconscious, during their sleep, these brain waves are going on through their mind, and that helps them practice what they're singing. And this is just a sonogram showing their songs recorded from their brain waves during their sleep. They're quite accurate interpretations of what the song would normally be. So they really do sing in their sleep and learn in their sleep, and that's the important thing. Anybody dozing now, I know you're actually paying full attention. Now, this is my last slide here, and I thought, having talked so much about male birds, and we've looked at how birds sing mechanically, and we've looked at how they learn, we've talked about why they sing, and they sing either to defend their territory or to attract a mate, and we've said that largely it's the male birds that do all the singing. Sometimes, though, when the going gets tough, the females have to join in. And in what's called duetting species, what we find that is the case. So when there might be a lot of competition for territories, there might be very high-quality territories, the males and the females will both sing. Generally, it's the female that starts off and is followed by the male, and they'll go around all day on their territories singing sort of, tweet, 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 I'm over here, tweet, 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 I'm over here. And where are you? I'm over here. Are you still there? Yes, I am. And come over here. All right. And it'll go on like this all day long. Some call it nagging, others call it beautiful song. Now, here we have the Rufus and White Wren, and I heard this at a conference and asked for a copy of this slide. Remember, if you remember what we said about what those notes represent on a sonogram, you'll be able to get what's coming up next. Those of you of a cultural disposition might be able to recognise the imitation that's coming up, and I'll give you the hint of Austria, even though it's actually recorded in America. So it starts off with the female, and then it's there we are, and then the male will come in straight away. Rufus and White Wren, the duetting species. I've been Rupert Marshall. You've been lovely. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
Do you have to mention blackbird? And they sing away morning and evening the same sort of song. It depends on that, they'll always be there. But you haven't mentioned
it. I do apologise for not being mentioning your favourite blackbird.
But you don't see them.
No, we don't see so many song thrushes these days. The underlying principles apply to all the birds. And blackbirds, as for example with robins, they will sing an awful lot of the time. What they'll tend to sing most, or when they'll sing most, is during the morning, the dawn chorus, and then the so-called dusk chorus at the end of the day. We tend to get a bit of a gap in the middle because they need to eat. And the reason we think that they sing in the dawn is that the earlier they sing, the fitter they are. They're essentially saying, look, I managed to feed up so much yesterday, I've got enough energy to start now, and I'm going to carry on singing longer than anybody else's. And that's why they'll carry on singing like that for long periods of time. And then again,
in the evening. Sits up there, though, day after day after day.
They will breathe and feed occasionally. they fall off the perch otherwise. Yet the blackbirds have delightful song, yes. As do thrushes, yes. Yeah.
How long does the bird live?
How long does the bird live? How long is a piece of string? fair point. Among the songbirds tend to live only for a few years. I'm generalising hugely here. So blue tits and grey tits, for example, we might expect to last for 3 or 4 years in the wild at most. Most for more like 2 or 3 years. Blackbirds for several years. 4 or 5 years perhaps. Swans will last for much longer, but then of course they don't sing at all because they're mute. So it does vary. And in some ways, how much they sing is an important aspect there, because if you can imagine that every cat in the hay bed and every natural predator is there looking for prey, and what do you do as a bird? You sit there and sing like crazy for half the day. This is just foolishness, really, because you're attracting all of these predators to you. And that's why we went another limit on when birds are singing. They will stop singing. They'll give their alarm calls when predators are around. And that's another reason why they eventually stop singing, is because they do get caught. And another reason why they don't sing outside of the breeding season.
Yes. Can I ask a question about willow warbler and chipper? Is it a case of a ring species? And if so, how come their territories now overlap so much? Their songs are so different, and yet they look identical. Have any DNA tests been done on them?
Excellent question. Yes, I don't know whether DNA tests have been done specifically on those two species. For those of you who don't know, the willow warblers have quite elaborate beetle songs, and the chiff-chaff just goes chiff-chaff, chiff-chaff all day long. And you have them in the hand, and the only way you can tell them apart physiologically, if they're not singing, is by the length of the seventh covert, is it? Something along those lines. So they do look virtually identical. Now, it could be convergent evolution, two birds which have come along, but they are part of the same, they're all part of the same silvered eave warbler family. I don't honestly know, to be honest, whether it's a case of ring species. I don't know, as far as I know, it's not the case of ring species. Ring species are fairly rare from that point of view. It is a good question. I'm afraid I don't have a good answer for it. I shall look it up.
Does light pollution affect bird song?
Does light pollution affect bird song? Indeed it does, yes. And some neat work has been done over in Sheffield in the last few years, showing that where we have lights on, they will sing much more, and they will sing earlier during the night. What's an interesting aspect there is whether the frequency, the wavelength rather, of the light affects what they sing as well. Because we know it does affect the number of insects which will come, and that then affects the number of bats. So when councils change to have energy-efficient lights, which only emit on one wavelength, that can have huge effects on the ecosystem. In terms of the birds, yes, it does have a big effect as well. And now councils are turning out lights at night to save money. That will now have another effect on the birds, which they may have to get used to. In busy areas like London, they'll sing during the middle of the night. It's an interesting idea, though, because there are two questions there, really. One, is it because the light is on? Or is it because it's so noisy during the day, they feel the need to sing at night, and they'll sing at night instead? But if they're singing at night, who's listening? And what are they going to do during the daytime? Because we know birds, as with most animals, need to sleep in order to recharge their brains and indeed to help with the learning process as well. So the question of what we as humans are doing to the environment in these simple behavioural ways is a very important one.
Is there an inverse correlation between the size of a bird and the amount of noise it makes? It always seems to me that it's the smallest bird that are the loudest.
They certainly are. I agree. The Jenny Wren we heard at the beginning there is a good example of that. Certainly when you're up close to any small bird when it's singing, they are incredibly noisy. But then again, I've been close to some macaws and the other parrots, and boy, they can make a noise too. I don't think there is overall any kind of negative correlation associated with small size with loud noise. There is, roughly speaking, a correlation between the size of the bird and the pitch at which it sings. So generally speaking, smaller birds will sing at a higher pitch than larger birds. But that isn't always the case. It doesn't always hold out.
You mentioned the light pollution. But can they see very well in the dark?
Can they see in the dark? It depends on the type of bird. Most of the birds that we associate in the garden birds, they are diurnal, they're most active during the daytime or indeed at dusk times. Can they see in the dark? No, nothing can really, what do we mean by seeing in the dark? Owls can, but they're really using their hearing. Bats, of course, do the same, and owls have very large eyes to help them do that. They can see, and it depends on the species, in some cases far better than us, but they're unable to penetrate complete darkness and tell what's there.
Well, Dr. Marshall, thank you so much for opening the world of birdsong and birds to us.
Yeah, I know.